Hello, everyone! Welcome to another episode of Digilogue Collection series. In this one, I'm actually going to talk about something slightly more modern by standards of vintage computers. And we're going to take ourselves a little bit to the late of 1980s, beginning of 1990s, and talk about Intel 8386. Specifically about getting a good computer that has at its core an Intel 8386 processor. There are a few videos floating online, some of them actually pretty good, about how to build one, either with modern components or just maybe period accurate by buying components off eBay. So I'm going to approach this from a slightly different angle. Rather than building one, how about we just get one off eBay and then we improve it? Because you know that's another option somebody can take, rather building one from scratch and having to find what components match, memory, processor, motherboard, and so on. If we get one that's more or less working with all the components inside, we can use that as a base to which our building blocks to build a really good 386 based machine. Why would you do that? You say, well, I mean, there are many games around the late to middle to late 80s and early 90s that play really well on the 386 machine. And you know, if you happen to have grown up with 386 machines like I did, and you may have some fondness for them, then maybe it's time for you to have one. So what I did is I got this machine off eBay for a decent price. And then I'm going to improve it and fix it and clean it and do all the things in order for us to get a really, really powerful 386 based machine that can play almost all the games from the 386 era, plus maybe some early 486 based games such as Doom. Woo! There's actually a little bit of story of how I got this machine, specifically because I actually was looking at the time for a 486 based machine. And the seller said this is a 486 machine, and I was a spec that he looked at it and it looked normal, so he said it was working, so I got it. And when I opened it and I powered it on, it said 386DX at 40 MHz, and I was like, whoa, that is not what I paid for. And I wanted initially to return it and get my money back, but then I realized that I had a gap in my collection and I didn't have a properly working 8386 machine, and I decided to keep it. And you know, since then I improved it and I did fixes and so on. So I want to walk you through the process of doing that. And like I said, start from working, maybe not so good configured machine somebody had in the attic somewhere, to make it somewhat period accurate, I would say, but powerful. All right, so let's start. Okay, so the way we are going to structure this is we'll take a look at the main board, what can we clean, what can we fix, what upgrades we can put. Then we'll look at the upgrades for the cards. Then we'll look at drives and other miscellaneous things. And once we're done with the hardware, we'll see what software we can install on it to complete our 8386 machine. All right, so I'll get the motherboard out and we'll take a look at it in a second. Everything is taken apart and removed now. The motherboard, the cards, the floppy drive, the hard disk, the power source, everything was disconnected. I took pictures of how everything was connected so we know where to put the cables. Very good advice, but I always take a picture of how the system was before I take it apart. A lot of those cables, specifically for like LED lights, power, reset and so on, need to go one or the other. So I did that, I took it all apart. Now I'm going to give it a little bit of cleaning, and when we come back, we'll start talking about the motherboard, which is the first step, and see what we can do to improve this on based on what it was with the minimum of funds. Stay tuned. Thank you. tool, by the way. All right, so let's take a look at the motherboard first. What can we do? What can we clean? What can we improve? First things first, when you get a computer this old, you want to check and most likely replace the rechargeable battery. Now, this battery, you're very lucky if it hasn't leaked. Most probably it did. But if it didn't, this is your lucky day, change it. This is a very simple 3.6 volt NIMH rechargeable battery. You can find them on eBay for about $7, a pack of four. So a very good, cheap investment for maintaining this board for a long time. You definitely want, this is the first thing you ever do, replace that battery. Did you solder the old one and solder the new one back in? Very simple. Second thing I did here is I wanted a math coprocessor, partly because some of the things I wanted to run on my 386 were math related, such as Vista Pro tools for rendering landscapes. So I got a 386. The processor on this board, actually, the reason I wanted to keep it is a 386DX version running at 40 megahertz, pretty much the fastest 386, naturally 386 processor out there. So if you want to put a math coprocessor in it, make sure that if you have a DX processor, you get a DX math coprocessor. I got an Intel one, which is supposed to be the fastest one out there. That will run you at about $25. The last thing I did here was improve the memory. I believe this came with a 4 megabyte of memory. I threw that out. I think there were 4 sticks of 1 megabyte each. What I did is I put 8 sticks, each of them with 4 megabyte, giving me a total of 32 megabyte of memory, which is a huge for the time. Almost nobody had a 386 machine with that much memory, but I wanted to be able to run things like Windows 3.1, maybe even Windows 95 and so on. So I wanted everything to run fine. This will get you, run at about maybe $40 for getting 32 megabyte in 4 megabyte sticks. Good investment. A lot of games will load faster, and everything just runs smoother. So to recap, first thing first, desolder the old battery. Even if it doesn't look like it is leaking, replace it. I got a math coprocessor and then a 32 megabytes of memory, and obviously cleaned it. So now we're ready to move on to the actual ISA cards. All right, let's talk cards. Obviously, look at the basics. You have to have your control card for floppy and IDE drives. The machine already came with it, and I think this one is a Ghost. I believe it's a Winbond. Yeah, that's pretty good. We'll do the job. And the machine also came with a video card, of course. I replaced that, and I suggest you do that as well. I got a 1 megabyte Trident 8900C VESA VGA card. This is pretty good. 1 megabyte will let you run almost all games from the 386 era. It has good, decent ISA bus performance. Of course, we can do a lot better than this. We can, if we can afford, you can get a Tank 4000 card or a 3000 card. Those are really good, really fast ISA cards. But I didn't want to spend that much money, and I got this one, which is really decent for what I want. And the next two things the computer didn't have, and I do suggest to get them as part of our upgrade. The first one is a sound card. In this case, I went to the cheaper version, the Vibra Sound Blaster Vibra 16C, which is the low-end version. However, for what I want, it works just fine. Of course, you could also go for Sound Blaster 064. That would work just fine. Slightly more expensive, but really good sound card for the games we are going to play. And the last one that I usually put in all my old computers is a network card. Important to have this port. And you have generally two choices here, either go with the Tricom version or the Intel version. In this case, I chose a Tricom. I have a box that's full of network cards, and I just picked one that was ISA. And this is really good because what it'll allow us to do is we allow us to connect our 386 to our LAN, and I have a Linux machine, which I'll show later, where I keep most of my software and games and tools and batch files and so on that I can easily download on my 386. This way I don't have to mess around with writing stuff on CD-ROMs or floppy disks. Having access to LAN with an Ethernet port, it's really, really, really useful. So to recap, you probably want to leave in on the board whatever you have for the whatever the box comes with in terms of the ID and floppy controller, most likely the job. Some are better than others, but really you won't see much of a difference. Get a better video card, at least 1 megabyte VGA card. Get a nice sound card. You can either go low end like this Sound Blaster Vibra 16 or get an O64. And definitely get a network card. All right, so cards are done. We should have enough slots to put this in. And then we'll move on to the drive and extra things we want to do with the box. All right, drives. We have three very simple three things here. We have the floppy disk, the hard disk, and the CD-ROM drive. The machine did not come with a CD-ROM drive. It came just with a three and a half inch floppy and I think about 200 megabytes hard disk. I changed the one. I have now a 1 gigabyte hard disk here, and I've also got not a CD-ROM but actually a DVD-ROM drive that will allow me to exchange data. For example, I can draw stuff on the CD and immediately load it. Also, if you ever want to install Linux, oh yeah, we'll talk about that. You might want to have access to a CD-ROM. So, floppy, hard disk, and the new thing we add is a CD-ROM. You could also go on the route of using a GoTek drive instead of an actual physical floppy drive. There are some advantages and disadvantages to do with that. I would suggest it. They tend to be slightly more expensive, but they're probably good investment for the future. I'll talk about it in a separate episode. Right. Now that we did deal with this, the one last thing I want to talk about is power. The machine came with a bundle of the pretty old power supply, which I'm sure it have died after a while, especially now that it's almost 30 years old. So I scrapped that and instead got this 80-300 watts power supply, which is much nicer. It's more, 300 watts really is more than enough than we want this for this board, but this means that it's going to work well within its parameters. Slightly quieter than the original one, and we'll just bring a longer life to our system. So power supply, optional, but it's good to do. All right, now that we got all the parts out, cleaned, we decided what are we gonna take out, what are we gonna put back in. We have all the drives, the motherboard is set up with the Matco processor, the new memory, we have our new cards, power supply. Let's put them all together and make the machine work with what we have. And then look on at what extra bits we want outside the machine, because there are a few of those as well. And then we'll also talk about software. Now that we have it all together, what can we do with it? All right, so I put everything together, all the cards, the motherboard inside, I rewired all the cables, and remember those pictures I took in the beginning? Yeah, those came in very helpful. Everything seems to be working. There's one more modification I made, which is a keyboard adapter. So old 386 motherboards used to take AT keyboards, which are a little bit pricey to find nowadays and not as easy. However, it's fairly easy to find PS/2 keyboards, just the one I have right here. And to make that work, I have this adapter, which is a PS2 to AT keyboard adapter. And with that, I can basically plug in much easier any PS2 keyboard I found. Generally, that would be easy to find and cheap. So I'll put this in, I connect the keyboard, and we'll give this a try. Okay, let's turn it on. From the software point of view, what I've installed is drivers for the network card, drivers for the sound card, and very, very important, very useful, I got the Phil's simple DOS disk. So I'll put a link in the comments below. Basically, it's a simple menu in the autoexec button config sys that allows you to select between having extended memory support, expanded memory support, CD-ROM, mouse, and so on. So it's very useful to get up and running with a DOS machine. So as you can see, 32 megabytes, that seems to be fine. We got a Trident video VGA before, mathematical processor seems to be running, and this is Phil's computer lab disk, like I mentioned. So it's a menu where I can choose. So let's say we want expanded memory plus mouse plus CD-ROM, and it comes with a CD-ROM driver. This is my sound card driver that I found. Again, I'll put a link in the comments about where we can find these kind of drivers. Everything is the computer came, like I said, with DOS 6.22 on it, and also had Norton Commander, which is quite useful. So yeah, there you go. It works. Everything is fine. So I'll let's wrap this up and recap what we have and what this started as, what we modified it with, and how much this whole adventure costed in the end. All right, so what did we start with? Well, we started with a simple 386 machine bought from eBay that worked. It was basic, but it worked. It had all the components inside and everything was fine. And then we started changing it, adding stuff, taking stuff out to make it a really good 386 machine. The processor was good. It was a 386DX at 40 MHz, the faster 386 you can actually get at actual 386. But we changed the memory. We added a mathematical coprocessor. We soldered a new battery on the motherboard. We added a network card. We added a sound card. We put in a much better video card. We put a bigger hard disk inside. And we put a good CD-ROM that actually works, CD drive that works. And all this together seems to be fine. We also changed put an adapter for to go from an ATE keyboard to a PS/2 keyboard. We added the speakers, a mouse, keyboard, and everything seems to be fine. The software that's running here, by the way, it's called Vista Pro, and this software does require a mathematical coprocessor. It can run, but very, very slow, with a mathematical processor emulator, but right now, obviously, it's running on our math coprocessor 387 we put inside. This is a really good piece of software. I spent many, many hours in my childhood playing with this and generating different landscapes. One day I might actually do an episode about it. But yeah, here you go. This is right now a very usable, very powerful for its time, 386 based machine, which we worked on, and we only started for a very basic 386. So I hope you enjoyed. Please subscribe to my channel, and see you next time.